In this video, we're going head to head once and for all to put this debate to bed. Get it? Hotels versus RVs. Plus, my recommendations for which hotels to stay in and which RVs to consider buying. And we're starting right now.
This is Adjuster TV.
Hey, it's Matt here with Adjuster TV. And for the best tips and tools for getting on the first call list as a Cat Property Independent Adjuster, subscribe now. Click on the bell notification and Bob's your uncle. And thanks to Susan who sent me an email saying, thank you, Matt. Great videos. I always learn something new. So very appreciated. Keep up the amazing work. Thank you so much for watching, Susan. Many people travel for work. However, most of those people are only out of town for a few days at most, and most of them have all their travel paid for. Independent catastrophe property adjusters, on the other hand, usually are gone for at least 2 weeks and can be on the road for up to a year or more. We normally have open-ended work assignments, so we have to find ways to keep our costs down without ending up in the no-tell motel sleeping with the bed bugs. So let's compare RVs versus hotel. Let's start with price. Hotels, with only an extreme exception, are going to be more expensive than most RV campgrounds on a nightly basis, as well as a weekly basis, and in most cases, even a monthly basis. So in order for the cost of a campground to get up above even $1,000 a month, it has to be in a highly sought after tourist area, right? So those exceptions are anywhere near a Disney theme park, Yellowstone, Glacier National Park, you're looking at upwards of $2,000 plus a month if they even do a monthly rate. Most RV campgrounds are going to charge between $250 and about $650 a month for full hookups, which is water, 30 to 50 amp electric, and sewer. And in a lot of cases, they're going to have Wi-Fi, and some places even still have cable. Many places charge extra for electric, but it's like a few cents per kilowatt hour. Our worst electric bill this past winter was $100 a month, and that was running two space heaters nonstop for the entire month. So a hotel with a kitchenette in it is going to be at least $300 a week in cheap areas like Junction City, Kansas, and more than $1,000 a week in expensive areas like Long Island, right? So most people who are looking into whether to run with an RV or stay in hotels has kind of figured this out, but there is a catch. If you decide, yep, I'm gonna do the RV thing, and then you say, but we're gonna buy an $80,000 fifth wheel and a nice new one-ton pickup to pull it around with, kind of defeating the whole purpose of getting a storm RV in the first place. You're gonna have over $1,000 a month in finance payments for your new truck and trailer, not to mention insurance and everything else for that great, big, beautiful, brand spanking new rig you got. And you can rationalize all you want. Well, it'll be great for family vacations. But when do people go on family vacations again? Oh yeah, in the summer when you're working cat. Get the wrong RV and it'll cost you at least twice what even a mid-range hotel would cost per month. Point goes to the RV unless you do it wrong, and boy, is it tempting to do it wrong. All right, so what about convenience? Well, that all depends on what you consider to be convenient. If having housekeeping make your bed and do your dishes every day sounds like something you'd like, then a hotel's probably gonna be the way to go. Because even in a big RV, if you leave one sock on the floor, you'll be tripping over it every time you get up to do anything. And you have to do your own maintenance on an RV or pay somebody to do it for you. At a hotel, you don't have to pay for any of that, and you don't have to do it yourself, obviously. When you're done with the hotel, you leave the key cards on the desk and drive away. When you're done with storm season in your RV, you're gonna have to clean it out, find a place to store it, and winterize it. Yes, even in Texas. Point goes to hotel here for convenience. And I'll give hotels another point for three reasons. A hotel can't break down on a drive halfway across the country. Also, there are some places where RV campgrounds are either always full or hard to find, like Southern California and Dallas being two, believe it or not. Also, many campgrounds have a rule where your motorhome or trailer can't be older than 7 to 10 years old, further restricting your options in many areas. But what about comfort? Well, in your RV, you can rig it out with satellite TV, PlayStation 4, all your favorite cookware. You can bring along hobby stuff like guns, golf clubs, musical instruments. You can even stock it with all the non-perishable food, clothes, and work supplies and have it all ready to go the moment you get the call to go to work. Try loading all that stuff into your car, then loading it into your hotel room, then unloading it from your hotel room back into your truck when it's time to go home, and then unloading it all back into your house. Yes, It is a big pain, trust me. One of the great things about an RV, especially if you're on the road for 6 or more months a year, is that you've got your home with you. The only thing that changes is the view out the window. Point goes to RV. So looks like we're tied, 2-2. I've done both extensively, and I will tell you that while I do prefer an RV, it's close, which means that I will never say I'll only ever use an RV and never stay in a hotel, because many times the convenience of hotels can hugely trump the cost savings of an RV. And speaking of, what's the right way to RV? After years of doing this, I've come to the conclusion that the ideal Cat Adjuster RV setup is a used 19-foot travel trailer, no more than $5,000 out the door max for cash. Ah, but Matt, that's so small. And I saw a 38-foot fifth wheel for sale for $20,000 off the MSRP. I can't pass up that deal. I could totally write it off too, and my family can go on vacations, blah, blah, blah. Let's think about this. The only thing that you're going to be doing on Cat is sleeping in this thing, okay? Any desk work you'll be doing is gonna be at the dining room table, okay? You don't need another desk when you're just gonna be sitting there with a TV dinner right there and with your laptop. A small travel trailer can be pulled by all pickups, most SUVs, and even some cars or minivans. You do not need a $65,000 dually to tow a 19-foot trailer, or even a 22-foot trailer, which means you're gonna be saving a pile of money on vehicle expenses. And remember, you're gonna be putting upwards of 25,000 miles a year on your gear. Why would you do that to an expensive pickup truck? Do not do it. And face facts, you're not taking your family on vacation in this thing. It's a tool for work. And even if you do, you can sleep you and your wife or husband and 2 kids for a long weekend at your mother-in-law's or a week-long drive to Yellowstone in the summer. If you pay cash for it, it's yours. If you buy a used one, 10 to 15 years old, you'll probably be able to sell it for close to what you bought it for. And I'm telling you, I don't care what kind of wholesale blowout deal the dealer's hollering about, that brand new 38-foot, 19,000-pound toy hauler fifth wheel will be worth less than half what you paid for it the second you sign your name on the finance contract. That's a promise. Do not do it. Bigger RVs require bigger parking spots, which are more expensive. They're also harder to maneuver in gas stations and, frankly, anywhere. Smaller RVs are going to have less complex systems, which will be easier for you to maintain yourself. They're easier to keep clean, and they're way cheaper to repair. Okay, so why not a spacious motorhome or fifth wheel? I mean, most of the videos I've done in the last year and a half have been done in my motorhome. Well, the exception is, and this is a great way to go, I mean, I recommend it, I'm doing it. If you plan to sell your home and store, sell, or give away everything else that you can't carry with you, then by all means, get a big fifth wheel or a toy hauler or a motorhome. Why? Because if you're going to full time in an RV, which if you don't know what that means you live in it, you're living full time in the motorhome or the RV, you'll need to have more storage than the typical travel trailer or fifth wheel will give you. We found that an older used motorhome had plenty of extra storage and the quality level we thought would be appropriate for full time use. This coach originally sold for a little bit under $300,000, which adjusted for inflation is $500,000. We have $500,000 motorhome and we bought it for $15,000 cash. Another argument against buying new, if you ask me, in only 25 years, this vehicle is worth 3% of its original purchase price. And while it's a little bit dated here and there, it still gets the job done just fine. It doesn't smell like smoke or cat piss or anything else. You can find one that doesn't have those terrible odors or all the problems that you hear about. And we also wanted a motorhome so that we could reduce bathroom pit stops and so that I didn't have to stop for lunch. Also, there's so much basement storage in this thing that we actually have extra room we're not using. Okay, well, what about hotels? I have favorite hotels as well. So depending on a hotel, you can generally negotiate a cheaper rate for long-term stays. Some hotels won't budge, but I found that Intercontinental Hotel Group branded hotels, which are Holiday Inn Express, Staybridge, Candlewood Suites, will have a monthly rate, and that many times I've been able to negotiate that down between 10 and 15%. And definitely sign up for the loyalty programs at Intercontinental Hotel Group, Wyndham, which is Super 8, Microtel, and Marriott, even if you go all in on an RV. You may want to stay in hotels when you're en route to and from a cat site, or you may get a crazy deployment like New York City or Puerto Rico or some other destination where it just doesn't make sense to take your RV. And dude, those points add up. I was able to stay in the presidential suite at the Intercontinental Hotel in Beverly Hills for 3 nights just on points back in 2012. And I'll tell you this, my number one favorite hotel for running cat is Staybridge. They give you a full breakfast, it's a nice place, and you have a kitchen and everything else. Question of the day, would you like a Starbucks gift card? Give me a hail yes in the comments below on YouTube, and I'll pick a winner at random on YouTube using a random comments picker. And I'll announce the winner on next week's video. If you're watching this not on YouTube, you can click on the lower right of the video and it'll take you to YouTube where you can comment and win. Again, hail yes. For much more information about being a cat property adjuster, head on over to adjustertv.com. And if you got value from this video, you can help me create more videos just like this by hitting the round subscribe button. Wondering what to watch next? Check out these videos. And as always, thank you so much for watching and have a great storm. You either love bacon or you're wrong.